Good morning.
Good morning.
Boy, what a surprise, and how glad we are to see you that are here today. It's just good to see Bobby and Sue back there. And it's good to see all of you here. And it's good to see a young man like Nick sitting there, you know it? Every time I see him here at church, it just thrills me to have him here. He's a fine young boy. And I know that he's a great football player.
He's an all-star.
He's an all-star?
An all-star champion, is that right?
Yeah.
Oh, you can tell us about that. That's great. That is great. One of these days we may hear something about you being up with the Heisman Trophy. But anyway, we are so glad to have you. We're so glad to have Kim up here singing in the choir with us. We would like to have any of the others be here also and sing with us. And David, Marion, doing okay today?
Yeah, fine. Just a little soul.
Okay. I know most of you probably already know that Marion had a wreck. Was it Saturday or Friday?
Thursday.
Okay. And she knocked down a few signs, but it kind of damaged her car. But
it was bad.
There she is.
Talking about
you. Just talking about you. Well, it was an accident. It didn't happen on purpose, did it?
No.
But we're so thankful that she survived, especially with her grandbaby in the car with her. And cars can be replaced, but grandkids can't. And so we're so glad they can't, but we're so glad God was with her. And I know she knows that God was with her. And she just wondered when it was happening, you know, what was going on. It happened so fast, I'm sure. But we are so glad to see you back in church. And I'm sure that Dudley will get you another car, right? Remember,
already had it. I think a bicycle or something would work. I mean, I'm just saying, we don't care about the car.
Yeah.
I was thinking about a tank or something. Something big. Where somebody can hit you and get you.
But anyway, Sue, it's so glad to see you. We know that you have gone through a lot that probably none of us know about. John has too, but John's improved. And we pray that each one of you will continue to improve every day. And that God will be so real to you that you can feel His presence. You know, as long as you feel God's presence, it does make a difference, does it not?
Yes.
To feel God's presence when you're going through these things. But you know, that's what He said. He will be with us always. We mentioned in the Sunday school class this morning about those of us, you know, cast into the fire furnace. And there was three of them put in there. And we were talking about how they didn't fear anything. Well, the reason they didn't fear anything is when he got down there in the fire, they found the fourth man down there. And they realized that Jesus was down there with them. So as long as he was down there with them, they didn't miss course. Nothing happened to them. So we got a lot of things to be thankful for, to know that Jesus is with us wherever we go, whatever we go through. And He will also not only bring us to it, but He will also carry us through it. And so we're thankful for Him and all that He does. And I listened to three preachers this morning. I tell you what, they preached some good sermon, which was all great. And we've got so much to be thankful about because we can be Christians. And that we can know Christ in a personal relationship and be one of His children and know that when we leave this world, we're going to a better world where there will never, ever be any suffering or pain or death or anything else. And we'll be with the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, let's have a word of prayer before we go into our service. Father, this morning we only ask for one thing, and that is for Your presence in a great way. You said where two or three are gathered that You'll be in our midst, and Lord, we know that You are. But we pray, Lord, that in some way that You would manifest Yourself to each one of us personally, that we could know that God is here, and that we could know that He is with us and He is in the service. And should there be one here that knows not Him as their Savior, oh God, bring a convicting a message to their heart to where they will feel like that this is a day that they need to receive Jesus Christ as a Savior, to give them the knowledge that when they pass away, that they know they're going to be in heaven with Him. Come today, Lord Jesus, in the power of the Holy Spirit and in the power of Your blood, and help us to speak the words that You would have spoken, and not speaking just words, Lord, but with anointed words, words that You anoint to the hearts of those that are going to hear today. And guide our mind, Lord, and help us to say those things that need to be said, and those things You don't want us to say, just take them out of our thoughts, Lord, and just strengthen us and help us to be able to represent Christ as the Savior of the world in a special way. May today be a day when You'll be honored and glorified in everything, and may we be able to give You thanks when we leave here for being who You are and for heading us through all of life. For all that's done, Lord, we'll thank You and praise You. And we thank You once again for those that have been out sick and those that haven't been able to come a lot, and that they are back this morning. We thank You for that. And we know that You have a hand in it. And we still know that You still got Your hand upon their body and that You'll continue. And for all these things, we thank You and praise You, for we ask it in the name of Your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
I guess this card here I need to read also. It says, many thanks, so deeply moved by Your thoughtfulness. Thank You all for Your prayers, calls, visits, food, and the gift certificate. You all are a blessing to me and Bobby. Love and prayers, Sue Jackson. Thank You. It's a nice card. And I'm sure that you know how much the church loves you.
Let's begin worship this morning with hymn 131. We gather together.
Show our appreciation to Him for what He's doing for the church. Father, thank you for letting us get it here, and for this beautiful day that you have given us. And for those that are here, may you come and speak to our hearts, each one of us, in a special way, that when we leave here, that we can say that it has been good to be in the house of God with God's people. And we thank you for each person here, and want you to make him realize just how important they are to you and to the church here too. And how much that we love them, Lord. And for all that's done, we thank you, praise you. In Christ's name we ask. Amen.
Opportunity to come together with our brothers and sisters in Christ and to worship in this time of Thanksgiving. So please remember that. And we're going to meet here at 5:30 for anybody that would like to go. It's a carpool over there. So please make note of that if you're able to go. At 5:30, we will meet here at our church and carpool over there to Riverbend. So please, again, just make plans to come. And, pardon? Yes, if they have asked us to help out by bringing a dessert or a drink, so please make note of that too, to carry over there. That Riverbend is handling the meal itself, and they just asked both of our churches, our church and the Baptist church across the street, to handle the desserts and the drinks. So please make plans for that. And if you were in the choir, we had the choir practice last Wednesday. We're going to meet over there, or be there around 5:45. But anyway, we're going to meet here at 5:30 anyway, carpool over there. So just make note of that. And this coming Saturday, please mark your calendars for this. We will meet on Saturday, November 27th. At 10 a.m. to deck the halls here at the church and decorate Christmas trees and, you know, whatever else comes along with that. Any and all help is greatly needed, so please make plans for that. You know, the Iron Bowl will be over by then, so, if you're all into football or whatever, unless you're watching another team or something, just if you can, if you're free Saturday morning at 10 o'clock, please make plans to come out for that, because we need all the help we can get. I had a realization the other day driving down the road, and I turned on a radio station and I heard Christmas music, and I said, well, here it is, it's coming. So ready or not, here it comes. So just please make plans for Saturday at 10 a.m. to be here if you can. And for our Christmas choir practice, if you would like to participate in this year's choir Christmas program, please make plans to come for practice on Wednesday night, December 1st at 5:30 here at the church. We'll run over our program there and run over some songs. Come hungry, Judy says. So please mark your calendars for that also. And also, we did this last year, we're going to do it again this year, but we're going to begin collecting items for Gay Nail and to carry over there for Tal Health Care. There's no basket on the front pew yet because we haven't located a basket, but since this is the first week we're announcing this, but by next Sunday there will be a basket on the front pew for anybody that would like to donate to gifts for Gay Nail. You have until December 13th, which is Sunday. We will be going to the nursing home that following Monday to bring anything you think that Gay Nail could use at Tal Health Care. Just if you bring candy or something, just make sure it's sugar free. And anything you think she could use, like, stuffed animals. I mean, I'm sure she'd love anything. So anything you think that she could use, please think of Gay Nail also. As most everybody knows, Gay Nail was a faithful servant here at this church. He did a lot for us. As you'll see next Sunday, these angels that are going to be placed on the altar, just about every one of them were broken, and she fixed every one of them, made them look like new. So that's one of the many things that she did. And also that window above Frankie right over here used to be clear, and she painted that herself. So just like I said, Gay Nail was a very faithful servant here at the church. So let's all just remember her as well this Christmas season. And again, our Way of the Cross food bank. Our containers are pretty full back there. But today is the deadline to bring items in time for the Thanksgiving meal this week at the Way of the Cross. So let's begin collecting for December. You will have until December 19th for December's food bank and clothes closet. And again, they are also in need of men's clothing and shoes as well. And anything donated will be very much appreciated. So please mark that in your head. And if you're ever at the grocery store or have any clothes in your closet that are just sitting there, that have been sitting there for 5 years, and you haven't gotten them out or whatever, there's some people that can really use those. So please remember that. And also, another announcement that's not in here, every year we decorate our tables back there in the fellowship hall for our Christmas dinner or lunch this year that we're going to have. Anytime after December the 5th, you can do this. We need 6 volunteers for the program, which will be held on December 19th. So please, I'll have that announcement in there. But if you'd like to participate in that, that was started several years ago. It's always been a good thing to see everybody's creativity they can come up with. So if you'd like to participate in that, anytime after December the 5th, you can participate in that. It's always a good time to see everybody's creativity out there. All right, do we have any other announcements today to be made? All right, well, I know somebody has a birthday this week. He's looking around. Well, if you don't know who it is, Mr. John Seymour, he's going to be.
31.
Pardon?
31.
31. All right. Well, happy 31 to you. His birthday.
He's 73.
Oh, wow.
And that's all.
All right. Well, 31 to 73.
Well, that's... You know, I think sometimes people get awful, and I got off a lot this morning. I really did. And I just think that I should. I just want to say I'm sorry to the church and to God and everybody else. I don't know what happened to me this morning. The barber probably knows. I don't know. I just don't know what happened. I don't know if anybody ever has one of those days or. See, I don't believe in that. Well, it's just one of those days. What does that mean? You know?
Yeah.
I don't know. I didn't feel well, but you know. That's
yeah.
That's no excuse.
We're here. Yes, we're glad you're here.
Well, I know, but that's still no excuse. I just want to say that I'm sorry that I acted like that. And y'all don't even know what it was, and I don't either. I'm sure Barbara knows, but she's nice, and so she
knows.
Well,
I'm
you sweet, precious girl. Well, I just think when you say, well, I didn't feel well, that's no excuse. Think of the millions and millions and millions of people that don't feel well. Don't punch me.
Charlie, I know what you're talking about.
I think it's because he's from somewhere around Calhoun County or something. Yeah, I know what you're saying. Well, I'm sorry.
Remember Barbara and Bobby in prayer.
Yes.
You're the caregivers.
That's
oh, yes.
Good. Thank you.
Well, we can't let you get by, John, without saying to you. So John's birthday is on Thursday. And actually, Thanksgiving Day, so we're going to be thankful for you on your birthday. How about that? But let's sing happy birthday to John real quick.
Happy birthday to you.
Scarlet. concerns, let's go to God in prayer. Oh God, how grateful we are to you this morning for blessing us beyond what we can imagine. We may have tough times in our lives. Stuff may happen to us. We may get sick or may require, you know, surgery or, you know, stuff may happen to us, you know, that's tragic or bad. But Father, even during all that, we know, just reassure us, and we know that you are still there with us at all times when we need you the most. Father, there are so many praise reports and joys in this church this morning. And Father, I just want to thank you for bringing those precious people back to us today. And just, you know, I'm sure they have felt our overwhelming prayers that we've been lifting up to you for them. And we're just so thankful for everybody that's here this morning. And we thank you for bringing Marianne and her grandchild through that wreck that she had this week, and just pray that you would just be with them as they are continuing to heal up from that wreck, and for the concerns that have been mentioned today, Cleela Dodd, Joby Nichols, and the Jordan family, I just pray that you would just make your presence known in their lives, and just let them know that you were right there, and that we have. There are people out there who they may not even know praying for them. Father, I pray for every name, every precious name that is listed on our prayer list today, that you would just touch them in a special way in whatever their need is, and just go with them as they whatever their need is. Only you know. Whatever concern is, and I pray that you just be with our congregation here. I pray that you're just with all the churches this morning that are gathering to worship you today. And I pray for our service tonight that we're going to have together as we unite with our brothers and sisters in Christ from our other churches here in this community. I pray that there would be an overwhelming showing from all churches, that we all just put aside our denominational differences and just come together and worship you. Father, we know that heaven is not going to be divided by denominations. So we just pray that you would just come in a special way in that service tonight and come into our service here, Father. I think I can speak for myself, but I know that I felt your presence here this morning, and I'm so grateful for that. Just continue with us in our service, and as we go into this week of Thanksgiving, Father, and this busy hustle and bustle coming up with Christmas and all the shopping and everything that's going to happen, just help us not to forget, Father, that we need to be thankful for all that you've bestowed on us. And I thank you for just blessing us and with this great country that we live in. Although there's some great concern going on in our country nowadays, Father, I just give you thanks and praise and for just bringing us all up in this country, Father, for we enjoy this freedom, and I just pray that you would just extend your hand of mercy on this country, for we are desperately in need of it. Again, just go with us in our service, and bless Brother Allen as he brings us our message today, and may it speak to somebody in this congregation today to let them be able to hear what you have to say to them. It's in Jesus' name I pray all these things. Amen.
Well, we do have so much to be thankful for, so listen to the words as the choir sings. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings.
Say I
They're just doing great. Any request to them?
Are you still on the mountain time?
I was surprised they didn't get up and tell us about that.
Well, I was going to.
Oh, wait.
But we have just been in total praise and thanksgiving since November the 5th. I've been there every day except for two. But they're doing great.
She probably already knows you by the sight, don't she?
I think she does. She recognizes my voice.
I need your prayers to pray for me as I attempt to try a song. Lock me up in a prison and throw away the key. Take away the vision from eyes that now can see. Deprive me of the food I eat, and even bind my hands and feet. But as long as I know Jesus, then I can still go free. That I could still go free. What kind of man would reach down his hand and do this for me? Unworthy to live, not fit to kill, then a man on the cross puts me in his will and says that I could still go free. I never could quite understand why a king would want to leave his throne to dun the road of an earthly man, feel the pain of flesh and bone, then to later trod a lonely path that led to Calvary, where the blood red stains, they broke all the chains that I could still go free. That I could still go free. What kind of man would reach down his hand and do this for me? Unworthy to live and not fit to kill, then a man on the cross puts me in his will
who says that I could still go free.
Turn on Highway 11 to Highway 11 is on this side of 59. So I didn't win that argument, that's for sure. Even my wife wouldn't even help me out on that. But anyway, we have a good time. Friends, I'm telling you, being a Christian is not a time where you're pressed down and you don't have a good time. You can have a good time in church. I know some people that don't even want you to even talk or speak in the church. Friend, it wouldn't do for them to come here, would it? Because we believe in talking and speaking in church. And I don't mean in a way to interrupt for something in the church service, but I'm talking about in a way of just enjoying being a Christian. And enjoy the fact that God has saved you. You know, we got a lot to be thankful for, to know that God, while we were yet sinners, that He loved us enough that He was willing to save us while we didn't want to be saved, you know? I wasn't seeking God. God was seeking me all the time. And I could tell He was seeking me because He would speak to my heart sometime, and I made so many promises to God before I became a Christian. I was going to do this and I was going to do that. And when He came down to it, I just got cold feet and I just wasn't able to do it. But finally, God got me in a corner. And friend, I'll tell you something. God can get you in a corner. And when He gets you in a corner, He can get you to a place where you will do what He wants you to do. Or we pray that He will, that you will make a decision that you're going to do what God wants you to do. I'm afraid that many people this way. And it's like being Christians. Sometimes I wonder about how long has it been since we that call ourselves Christians and know that God has saved us, how long has it been since we have ever responded to an invitation and ever come down to the altar and just prayed a little bit, just prayed as Christians? Well, you know, most Christians are afraid to come down after they get saved, because they're afraid they'll say, people say, well, what have they done? What have they done wrong? Why they haven't go down to the altar? But I don't think you ever get past the time when you can go to an altar and pray. I don't think we ever get past the time when we don't need or have something in our life that we want to pray about and talk to God about. So why don't we keep responding to God's call when he tells us to do these things, but for some reason or another we just don't do this. But anyway, Paul said, tells us that the Thessalonians turned to God from idols. They did not get up in a testimony meeting and say, we do not go to the temple of Apollo anymore. No need to say that, because they were separated unto the Lord Jesus. A Christian separated from something and not separated unto Christ will have a barren life. Their life will be without joy, and they will become critical and cynical of everybody else that enjoys freedom. You know, I think Paul said, I can do all things through Christ. He said, I can do anything. I can do anything I want to do. You say, well, you can't do anything you want to do. Well, you can, because when God comes in your life, you only want to do those things that please Him. So you can do whatever you want to do as long as God is leading your life, because He's going to lead you in the right pathway. There's a phrase in the marriage ceremony that says, do you promise to love and keep yourself unto him or her and to no one else? Now this is separation unto one person. This is what marriage is. Imagine the fellow on the first night of the honeymoon saying to his new bride, honey, I hate to tell you this, but I got a girlfriend over here in the next town. I think I'll go over to see her. Now how would that go? Now would that go on the night of your wedding? Or on your honeymoon? Well, it wouldn't go too well, would it? But I'm just telling you, this is the way it is. Christians practice this kind of separation. If you are separated from Christ, you'll have a life that appeals rather than one that turns people off. I'm afraid sometimes that we as Christians are living a life in such a way that it turns people who are not Christians, it just turns them away, and it makes them cold and indifferent, and they don't see nothing in their lives that they makes them want to have Christ. But it said that a Chinese girl said one time, Christians are salt. And salt makes you what?
Thirsty.
Now think it over. Do you make anyone thirsty for Christ? I mean, when they look at your life, does it make them thirst for Christ because of what they see in your life? Do they really? Now that's a good question. And I hope that you have a good answer for that. That's what God wants us to do. The word separated in the Greek is the same word from which we need to get our word horizon. Now, I don't know about you, but for a long, long time, I'm just afraid to fly. But fine runnings on Wills Hall, a plane that had been overhauled at the basin where I was stationed. And they were going to take it out one Sunday for a trial, and they came in and said, any of you guys want to go for a ride on the plane? Well, I'd never been up in one. I said, I'm going to go up in this plane to see what it's like. Well, we got up in this plane, and we didn't even have a parachute. I said, where's our parachute? He said, we're not going to be high enough to jump out. Well, I was going to jump out anyway. I don't know what I was on the parachute for. It'd take more, I guess, faith in me to jump out with a parachute than you would anybody. I don't know how these people do these skydiving things, you know, and just let that just float down through there like they do without pulling that cord and getting that thing open so it would stop the fall. But anyway, what I'm trying to say is here, this word that we're talking about here, the horizon. When you get in a plane, your horizon expands greatly. I mean, I've got on a plane before, and while I was going out the plane, it was just pouring down rain. It was thunder and lightning, and the clouds were black and everything. And the higher you went in that plane, you broke through all these clouds and everything. You get up there over the clouds, and your horizon is you can just see so far. And I tell you what, there was sun shining, no rain whatsoever. Right below you, it was raining. But I could see everywhere just about what it looked like. And it was such a beautiful sight. You can see those cloud pillars, you know, way up there high. But there you were above. You were above the clouds. So when you find Christ, your horizon, you see so much better. Especially the things of God. You understand, you see things better than you've ever seen them before. And a greater distance. And you can just see everything. It looks like when you're flying up there. But this is a wonderful thing. But he brings you to the place where your horizons are enlarged. And this is what Paul meant in 1 Corinthians 13, chapter 11, verse 11. When I was a child, I spake as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. When you were a child, I was a child one time. It's been so long I've done forgot about it. I don't remember any of my days when I was a child. Can any of you remember, look back on your past and remember all the things you did when you were a child? Well, Paul said, when you're a child, you can speak like a child. But since I've become a man, you put away the childish thing. When you were a child, and I know that a lot of us done this, and I lived in a little community there where there was not a whole lot of boys that lived there in the community, but there's a lot of girls. And some of them girls would ask us to play house with them, you know. You ever play house? Like the girl, you know, play house? And we would even play house with them. But as we grew older, our horizon expanded, and we said, we're not going to play house anymore. We're going to go outside, we're going to play ball. We're going to play football. And we're going to shoot marbles. Any of you know what shooting marbles is? Well, we used to do that on dirt. Just the ground. That's all. We didn't have that else. No other way to play. On the street where I lived, I was a champion marble shooter on that street. I took pride in that because nobody else could shoot those things like I could. And I could knock them marbles out of the middle of that thing and just keep on knocking them out one after the other. But that's really a small thing for me to remember what I done when I was a boy. Oh, becoming a Christian does not mean that life becomes little and narrow. Rather, life broadens out to include thrilling and wonderful experiences. And since I've been a Christian, I've had some of the most wonderful feelings and experiences in my life that I guess that I'll ever know about until Jesus comes back and shows us what heaven is like. Then we might know that. But Paul says he is separated under the gospel of God. In other words, man did not create the gospel. When you and I came on the scene, the gospel had been in existence for hundreds of years. He didn't wait until we got here to see if we had a better plan. The gospel, it is God's gospel, and we can take it or we can leave it. Romans chapter 1 verse 2 says, which, talking about the gospel, which he had promised before by his prophets in the Holy Scriptures. The gospel is not brand new, but had been promised all the way through the Old Testament. A message that God loves us, and Christ to man. It brings us into a love relationship. He loves us and he gave himself for us. How wonderful is that? That God loved us enough to give himself on the cross for our salvation. Verse 2 through 6 gives the definition of the gospel. First of all, it is all about Jesus Christ. Romans 1:3. Concerning his son Jesus Christ our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh. The word concerning is the Greek preposition peri, P-E-R-I, which is used in periscope and perimeter, and means that that which encircles the gospel is all about Jesus Christ. Everything we say, the center of it should be about Jesus Christ. That's the gospel. Whatever you say, encircle it all around you, bring it in about all the things that Jesus has done. It encircles the gospel all about Jesus Christ is what is done. He is the Son of God, and he is Jesus Christ, our Lord. People often say we need the religion of Jesus Christ. We don't need the religion of Jesus Christ because Jesus didn't have any religion. He did not need one. You know, I don't even like that word religion when we're talking about Jesus. Jesus is not a religion. He is a Savior that will save us from our sin and the only one. And nobody will ever be saved apart from Jesus Christ, the Son of God. And it should be all about what he has done. Jesus Christ actually is God. He cannot worship. He cannot even worship. He is to be worshipped, but he does not worship anybody else. He is to be worshipped himself. Now, but he prayed. Well, somebody said, but he prayed one time. Yeah, he did. He took the place of humanity and he prayed as a means of accommodation. At the grave of Lazarus, the Bible says that Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me, and I know that thou hearest me always because of the people which stand by. I said, that they may believe that thou hast sent me. He prayed to help our faith. He is also the seed of David. This is his humanity. He is virgin born and declared to be the Son of God. Now, I don't know what you think about Jesus Christ being virgin born, because you would say, well, that, according to doctors and scientists, that's impossible. It's impossible for him to have been virgin born. But you know what? God is always able to do the impossible. Man, there's a lot of things that are impossible to man, but with God, there is nothing impossible. And listen, the whole fact of the gospel and the truth of the gospel is that Jesus Christ was born of a virgin, which means that he was without sin, because he had no father. He had no human father as his father, and he was born of a virgin, and therefore he had no sin. No sin whatsoever, because that's the way that sin was transmitted through Adam and Eve and all the human race, because they're the ones that sin. God said, in the hour that you sin, you shall surely die. And from that moment, Adam and Eve began to die because they sinned against God. Well, Jesus never did. He is declared to be God with power. Romans chapter 1, verse 4 says, and he was declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit. By the resurrection from the dead, the resurrection did not make him the Son of God. It simply revealed who he was. Well, I am thankful for one thing this Thanksgiving. I'm thankful for that clock back there. And I don't have to look at my wife to tell me. I see it's almost straight up and down on 12 o'clock. Boy, that finished just right, Dave. So if you have an invitation, some, you'll come. If there's anyone here that has a need, you need to pray about yourself. If you want to accept Jesus Christ as your Savior, if you want to unite with this church, I want you to feel free to come while we have our invitation. So we'll sing. What's the number now?
382.
Thank you.
something should happen to you this day, that you would find yourself in the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ in heaven. Mm-hmm. That's the most important question that the person can answer. Or do you know if something happened to you today that you would go to heaven? If you can't say, I know, the Apostle Paul said, I know in whom I have believed, and I'm persuaded that he will keep that which I committed unto him against that day of judgment. Because there won't be any judgment for you. You're going to bypass the judgment because your sins will be judged, have been judged in Jesus Christ when he died on the cross, because he had all the sins of the world on his shoulder. And those that receive him, your penalty has already been paid because Jesus died. He paid for your sin and mine. And so that's a great thing. But may the Lord be with you and as you go home. We thank you for each one of you that's here today. And just we're so thankful that many have got to come back to church, and we're thankful for that. And Nick, we're really glad to see a young boy like you come and sit. You see how Nick comes in and he sits on the front bench. Not many young boys that do that. But we're thankful for that. And we think about you a lot. And when we see you, it makes us feel so good to see a young boy that would come into a church and listen to an old man preach. But we thank you for coming. You just keep being the kind of person you are. One of these days, you may be a great preacher. They may make you a great evangelist. That wouldn't be bad, would it, Pat?
No.
You may lead thousands to the Lord, and that would be great. May the Lord just be with each one of you, and we thank you for your presence here, and may He go with you as you leave here and walk with you and provide and supply the things that you need in life and keep you close to Him and put the pathway out there that is the way that we should go. And in all that, we give Him thanks and praise. You are dismissed.
Good morning. I'm Sue Jackson. Hi, again.
Thank you. 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 Thank you.